So Jack, welcome everybody to another CAR seminar. This is a very special one, I think, that we have Richard Shing from Vanuatu, Ni-Vanuatu archaeologist, and these sorts of occasions are very, very rare at the ANU, and of course there's very few Pacific Island archaeologists, of course, but we're very privileged today to have Richard here with us. Richard is from the southernmost island of Vanuatu, Ni-Tiam, and was inspired at high school to be involved in archaeology. I don't know why he was, but because there certainly wasn't any particular jobs going in Vanuatu at that time. But he joined excavations with us, Matthew Spriggs and myself, in 1996 as a high school student. He tells me that he decided then that archaeology was what he wanted to do. He then went off. We tried to line up a scholarship here at the ANU, but he was those weren't available at the time. We went off to UPNG for 4 years as the archaeological program there began to dissolve. And he came back to the Cultural Centre and has been essentially the resident archaeologist there since about 2002 or something. It's been a wonderful time working with Richard. He's, as I say, very, very passionate about archaeology, but one of his real fortes is connecting with the wider communities. He's recognised by all sorts of people when you go to villages, his name or his work. And for Matthew and myself, it's been a wonderful sort of entree into sort of disseminating the research and connecting with those communities. And I think having someone like Richard on a permanent basis at the Vanuatu Cultural Centre has really been a major benefit for that sort of program. And I would argue that the sort of grassroots knowledge in Vanuatu in relation to archaeology is some of the best in the Pacific. So anyway, I'll hand it over to Richard.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I will be giving a short talk on the archaeological research, community collaboration, and participation in my country, Vanuatu. At the close of the Lapita Conference in New Caledonia in 2002, indigenous archaeologists saw that there was a clear need for further to promote archaeology more broadly at a community level, to create wide awareness and understanding for all Pacific Islanders, young and old, what archaeology involved, what it tried to achieve, along with its associated implications. For a long time, Pacific Islanders have been wary of archaeology, often associated it with grave digging, a practice that, of course, in many Pacific cultures is considered sacrilegious. Over the last 15 years, the Vanuatu Cultural Centre, in collaboration with a number of foreign researchers and guided by the Vanuatu Cultural Centre research policy, has been running an active program increasing public awareness in relation to archaeology. This has involved such activities as running training workshops for Vanuatu fieldworkers, school tours of excavations, often include some level of participation, mounting exhibitions, producing publications in the form of booklets, posters, and comic books in the three national languages, and regular features on national TV, radio, and newspaper. Through these collaborative awareness programs, an increasing number of Ni-Vanuatu have gained a much greater appreciation of archaeology and its potential to contribute to a better understanding of the country's 3,000-year history.
Yeah.
Firstly, just to set a basis of what I'm going to talk about, I'll talk about a little bit about the Vanuatu Cultural Centre. It was initially set up in 1957 and was called the New Hebrides Cultural Council. And its role was to assist and supervise researchers that were coming into the country to do humanities research. When the country gained independence in 1980, the name was changed to Vanuatu Cultural Centre, and it's tasked to preserve, promote, and protect custom and culture in Vanuatu. In 1985, the Vanuatu government established a moratorium on all humanities-based research. And as the distinguished Kirk Hoffman explained, this was because mainly, one, the newly established government resented some of the early views of researchers and missionaries from the pre-colonial period to the early phases of the colonial period on the indigenous population. And that too, they believe it is better for Ni-Vanuatus themselves to be conducting their own research. Researchers and missionaries from the late 19th century up to the early 20th century would examine the local population from a very Eurocentric perspective. And so the early literature was quite biased when discussing the lives of the indigenous population. This was quite common, not only in Vanuatu, but in a lot of places around the world in those days. And in Vanuatu, where Europeans were coming into contact with the local population and were portraying their way of life as being savage, non-civilized, and quite backward. Whereas in reality, these cultures are an evolution of thousands of years of living in their respective environments, coping with the stresses that transformed themselves to suit the social and environmental concerns they faced. To the early educated Ni-Vanuatu, most of them became prominent leaders during the early phases of independence in that time. Many of these early accounts portraying our ancestors was equivalent to gross insult to our custom, culture, heritage, and history. Ni-Vanuatu are brought up to respect and cherish their cultural way of life and to consider the knowledge of our ancestors passed down to us as being paramount. And even today, people still view the white man way of life as being inferior. Growing up as a child, we were taught to work together as a community, to assist each other to survive, and it is custom that acts as a guideline to ensure prosperity for all. The couple of decades leading up to independence saw a gradual change in the views, perception, and methods used by visiting anthropologists and other researchers when they began immersing themselves into the local communities in order to document their lives from the inside, as in comparison to previous writers of our culture who stayed in the community but lived separately. Many of these later researchers would live with the local communities in their homes, thank you very much, eat with them, and went to some extent of partaking in the custom ceremonies and economic activities in order to be accepted as part of the group. By the time we obtained independence from England and France, the new government realized that some sort of guideline was needed for researchers to adhere in order for more of the research to be conducted correctly, and that researchers would not disturb the way of life of the people they come into contact with. Thus, the moratorium was enacted to provide time for the government to put together a policy for all researchers researching in custom culture and the history of Vanuatu to follow. The Vanuatu Cultural Research Policy was endorsed in 1994 by the government of Vanuatu, and subsequently the moratorium was lifted. You would think that after a decade of moratorium, there would be a large influx of researchers into Vanuatu, but that was not the case. It enabled a more collaborative effort and a better understanding between researchers and the communities they were working in. The Vanuatu Cultural Centre Fieldworkers, I'll briefly explain that. The Fieldworkers program was initiated by Kirk Hoffman in the late 1970s. One of the Vanuatu Cultural Centres, in the 1970s, initially involving just men, and it was tasked to assist the Vanuatu Cultural Centre in sourcing and collecting oral tradition. They also have an annual meeting and called the Vanuatu Fieldworkers Workshop, where every year a topic was chosen, discussed, recorded, and stored in the Vanuatu Cultural Centre's archives. Their role has developed positively over the years. With the assistance and cooperation from overseas institutions and agencies to include the collection and preservation of knowledge in traditional ceremonies, cultural rituals, genealogies, and any other cultural practices, and in the form of written accounts, audio recording, digital recording, and visual recording. What started as a men-only program included women in 1989, now comprises of an almost equal number of men and women who assist the Vanuatu Cultural Centre and researchers coming from overseas and within Vanuatu in whatever they needed to do in the islands, especially with logistics and explaining the work of the Vanuatu Cultural Centre and the researchers or and whatever they'd like to do. It was therefore imperative that these field workers went through regular training so that they could easily explain whatever work we wanted to do in the field. The Vanuatu Cultural Historical Site Survey of Vanuatu National Register. The Vanuatu Cultural Historical Site Survey, or VCHSS, in short, was set up in 1990 by archaeologists David Rowe and Jean-Christophe Gallipole to create and maintain a database of sites of cultural, archaeological, and historical significance. Not only did they collect data from these sites, but a major component of their mission was to inform and educate people in these areas they visited on the importance of their cultural and historical and archaeological sites and why and how they should be preserved. Through tireless efforts of those who assisted in the early stages of the VCHSS, more and more people in Vanuatu have become more aware of issues surrounding these sites. It is common knowledge that the gradual flow of missionaries into the Pacific from the east to the west led to the extinction of many traditional practices and knowledge concerning the everyday life and the use of the land. As these early missionaries introduced the Word of God to the people, most missionaries forbid the traditional way of life and the rituals and customary practices associated with them. Coupled with a mass reduction in the population size in the islands during and after the missionaries arrived, a cache of valuable knowledge of cultural sites was lost during that period, up until the independence of the country in 1980. After the establishment of the Vanuatu Cultural Center, and eventually the VCHSS, an ever-growing number of people now understand the importance of these sites and appreciating the value and relevance in the world today. Even though in the mid-2000s, the VCHSS changed its name to Vanuatu National Register, its role remained the same. Fieldworkers training workshops. In 1996, a training workshop started in Mangas, in the western side of Hepate, in collaboration with Dr. Stuart Bedford and Professor Matthew Spriggs from the Australian National University, initially to train the VCHSS staff, but as interest grew, a number of fieldworkers were included. From 1996 to 2003, training workshops were conducted annually, and eventually all of the Vanuatu Cultural Centre field workers at the time, including men and women, went through the training of basic archaeological excavation methods and also training on how to conduct cultural surveys on cultural sites. Further training workshops were carried out on offshore islands of Malekula, namely Urupif, Uri, Wala, Achin, Rano, Vau, and Maskelin from 2001 to 2005. These fieldworkers would then go back to their various islands and not only would assist in the dissemination of information about archaeology, but also could identify potential excavation sites. A classic example is the discovery of the Lapita site at Tayoma, where Salko Nyona, a Vanuatu Cultural Centre fieldworker, correctly identified a piece of Lapita shard brought to him by Charlie Nati, a bulldozer driver who was working on the site, removing dirt for the development of a prawn farm. This led to one of the most important discoveries of Lapita to date. Prior to and between and after archaeological training workshops, excavations were also taking place in other areas and islands in Vanuatu. During these excavations, locals would be hired to assist, which provided an opportunity for the archaeological team to talk about archaeology, participating locals, the schools within the vicinity of the excavation, and all people who showed interest in archaeology. archaeology also provided a good topic for cover time conversations. Archaeological projects and awareness. School visits. Young people constitute a large portion of the population of Vanuatu, as in most countries in the world. There is it is very important to educate this generation so more people can know about archaeology in the years to come. Being a very active component of the population, they can pass on their learned knowledge of archaeology to their friends, parents, and extended families. We started to bring in schools to visit the archaeological sites during the fieldworker training in Mangas in 1996. This was done primarily to increase awareness on archaeology in schools and for the students to get exposed to archaeology and to see archaeologists at work. During these early school visits, the students would be given a short talk introducing archaeology and the theories surrounding them. They would then be taken on a tour of the site. Schools in Port Vila and around Efate, the island of Efate, were invited to the dig, and sometimes whole schools would turn up. In the beginning, it was quite chaotic. So eventually, we put together a program whereby schools that intended the visit would notify us in advance so that we could limit the number of classes coming on a particular day and also space them out so that all of them could visit, but in smaller groups. Students of all ages, ranging from kindergarten to the university levels, would visit the sites and they all showed great enthusiasm in archaeology, mainly because most of what they learned was relatively new to them, but also due to the fact that not only do they learn about their history and the past, and also other subjects such as geography, geology, biology, to name a few, but that are used by archaeologists to assist them in analyzing a site. Due to the delicateness of archaeology, as we all know, the groups that visited the excavations were allowed to view the work in progress but could not partake. An opportunity arose in 2008 that enabled students to get a hands-on experience on what archaeology was all about. At the Teoma Lapita site, there was a large mound feature, you can see on the top corner up there, top right-hand corner, yeah, top left-hand corner. It was a large mound created by bulldozers as they were working there prior to the discovery of the site. And it consisted of a mixed material from the Lapita period up until just before European contact. When the mound was discovered in 2004, it was realized that there was much cultural material in it, and it was decided that the mound would eventually be sifted to collect the artifacts and faunal remains. In 2008, the archaeological team decided that it would allow students to dig and sift through the mound to find and collect archaeological materials from this mound feature. This would not only assist the team in retrieving cultural material from the disturbed mound, but also students would have the opportunity to feel of what archaeology is. The turnout of that year and the years to follow was quite amazing. A lot of students were very excited, and even though they took turns in digging, sifting, washing, drying artifacts and faunal remains that they found, most would really rush here and there and try as much as possible in a short period of time they were on the site to find as much materials as possible. Many schools would plan to stay for the whole day and would bring their own refreshments so the students did not have to go back to the school for lunch. Everybody had a great time, from the youngest to the oldest, and sometimes it was quite hard for the teachers to persuade the students to get back on the buses, to get back to school. Most students that came to the excavations were very, very interested and excited in what they learned, because part of the curriculum of the school archaeology was part and partial of the curriculum. Due to the increasing interest shown by schools and the general public, including many prominent government officials, the Vanuatu Cultural Centre decided to start putting out short publications on the archaeology work that we were doing and the finds that we were coming up with. At that time it was important, since most of the literature available in the schools and the public was very outdated, or in a language or in English that was quite difficult for the ordinary ordinary person to understand, to fully comprehend. Another equally important reason as to why the Vanuatu Cultural Centre started printing materials was to hand out to the schools and the general public, so that when they left the site, they could still have an idea or memory of what they saw when they were there. One very important feature of these publications was that the language we used in them was very simple, so that people of all ages, backgrounds could read and easily understand it. We began by creating this very small 6-page booklet in 2005 in Bishlama, which is the local lingua franca, titled Waninya Archaeology, What is Archaeology? That briefly explained archaeology and Lapita and introduced some of the findings in Teoma and answered some of the most common questions asked by the students on how to, for example, how to identify sites and so on and so forth. This book was handed out to all the students, and we do not have any copies of this anymore. It was so successful that in 2008 we did reprints of it. The updated version in 2008, we increased the number of pages to 8 pages, and thanks to funding from AusAid, we were able to do it in 3 different languages. For those who do not know Vanuatu much, we were colonized by Britain and France, so we have English, French, and Bishlama as our official languages. And the reason why we included English and French in the first place was because it was the language that we used in the schools, and so if we could incorporate these kind of information into the classroom, we have to put it in these languages. I remember from my old school time, we were not allowed to speak Bishlama in schools, and Bishlama literature was sort of banned from school. The AusAid funding for the school program in 2008 also enabled the Cultural Center to document and prepare school individual school reports. What's just coming up is the 3 languages of the booklet, which we produced later on. The first part of the report which we produced for the schools, individual reports for the schools, consisted of an introduction to archaeology, outlining the basic archaeological methods, ideas and theories. The second part sort of summarized in a very basic kind of way the findings we had of Teoma site to that date. And the last part of that report talked about the school visit, that particular school, when they visited, what they did, and including lots of pictures and the findings which they... That's the school report, sorry. The one which was just up earlier are reports which we did in Bishlama and English for excavations conducted in the various sites of Mangas, Teoma, Malekula, and the northern part of Vanuatu. Eventually we distributed these reports back to the places where we actually conducted the excavations from. In 2009, we put out a booklet titled Olbubu, Oliplasim Bodi Blong Olketa, Body Decorations and Ornaments, in the 3 languages to coincide with an exhibition which we were having at that time, which I will talk about later on, exhibitions. And also in 2010, we produced another booklet, Lapita Peoples, which we were very fortunate to have an opportunity to go to Paris to do a very big Lapita exhibition. And that book was done because of that Paris exhibition. In 2005, the Vanuatu Cultural Center released its first poster in Bishlama on the findings of Teoma, titled Archaeology, Molapita and Teoma, Archaeology and Lapita in Teoma. We got a lot of positive response from this poster, but also one thing which we found out which was not really good about this poster was there's too much information cramped into the poster. We realized this so that in 2007, we released the second lot of posters in 3 languages called Lapita in Vanuatu, and we tried to minimize the text, put more pictures into it, it would look more attractive. In 2010, we held a two-week exhibition titled 30 Years of Independence, 3,000 Years of History, and created a poster to commemorate that event. I will talk about this exhibition later on. All the materials that were produced for education purposes, and we tried to distribute them to as many people as possible, especially in schools, because when you pass them off to schools, you cover a more wider audience in comparison to give them out to single individuals in the public. Exhibitions. Exhibitions are a very efficient means of educating and attracting public interest. And even though we are a small unit at the Vanuatu Cultural Centre, we have put together and taken part in a number of exhibitions. In 2010, we launched the Ol Bubu Oli Plasi Molkata exhibition, like I mentioned before, body decorations and ornaments, where we display different ways that people in the past adorned themselves or beautified themselves. From the beginning, during the Lapita period, some 3,000 years ago, up until the period after we became colonized by France and Great Britain. This exhibition comprised of a wide selection of archaeological artifacts, old ethnographic photos, and artifacts from the ethnographic period. To coincide with this exhibition, we produced a small book and a set of four posters in the three languages so that we could send out to the schools who could not visit the exhibition, and they could display them in the library or any public area. The students can have access to the information we have on the exhibit. The 30-year independence and 3,000-year of history exhibition in 2010 was a means to again stress the importance of Lapita in our history. We held the exhibition a couple of weeks before the country's 30th independence celebration, and we want the public of Vanuatu to realize that compared to the 30 years of being independent from the two colonial powers, people have been living, surviving, and flourishing independently from all outside contact for the last 3,000 years. The Oceanic Ancestors exhibition housed at the Caledonia Museum for 3 months from November 2010 was a collaborative effort between the Vanuatu Cultural Centre, the Institute of Archaeology for New Caledonia, and the Pacific, the Australian National University through Professor Matthew Spriggs, and Dr. Stuart Bedford, and the Caledonia Museum. It is probably the largest Lapita exhibition ever held to date, and not only do we have archaeological materials from Vanuatu and New Caledonia, but we had samples of Lapita materials from throughout the Lapita area, from Papua New Guinea right down to Tonga and Samoa. To coincide with this very big exhibition, we published the book Lapita People, which was not only a big hit in Vanuatu, but also Paris, where we first started distributing them. Just for the information, the book was printed in the morning before we took off for Paris. We took them out from the printer, went straight to the airport. Another very easy and free means of disseminating information of archaeological issues and findings is via the newspaper and through the radio and TV. We make it a must that every time after an excavation, we put together a couple of articles sent to the newspaper or newspapers around town. This is in order for the public to be aware of our work and what we're doing and the results of the excavation we have conducted. As you can see, this is some of the extracts from the newspapers and from the excavation we've been doing. And just this last one, I just have to show this, a Nichum Lapita discovery. I'm from a Nichum. A Nichum Lapita discovery. We didn't actually find Lapita in Vanuatu, in a Nichum, but I just put this up so that we have to understand when we put out information to the public, we had a journalist come and interview us on this, and he wrote it up. And because Lapita is a name that is quite well known in Vanuatu, people associate Lapita with every kind of pottery, which is quite wrong. But I just put this up so that probably in the future when we want to disseminate the information, especially to newspapers, and we know how journalists like exaggerating on things and so on, so we'll try to make dramatic whatever information they put out. We have to be very careful in what we tell them. And I think from now on, we should. What we will be doing in Vanuatu is we'll be writing the stuff ourselves. Most of the newspaper articles up there we actually wrote, but for this one they came and interviewed us, and unfortunately the typing was quite dramatic, but not really correct. The Vanuatu Cultural Centre also has a weekly and hourly program in the Vanuatu National Broadcasting Corporation, which readers from nearly all the islands in Vanuatu read. A few weeks before we venture out to the excavations, we go on air to let the people in the areas know of our arrival and know what we're going to do. Also, after each excavation, we do another radio broadcast to thank some of the communities which we working with us and who have assisted us in the excavations, and also to give some preliminary feedback on the findings we make in these excavations. I have this nice picture here of the distinguished Matthew Spriggs, and he's there with a new MP of ours, Ralph Reagan-Vanu, doing a live radio broadcast at one of the radio stations. More than two documentaries have been prepared by the Cultural Centre, video documentaries, and have been airing every now and then in the local TV station. In addition, we have had over the years visits from TV stations overseas. We've had the Catalyst from ABC come visit us and do documentary, TV crews from New Zealand, and also we had a South Korean TV station come and interview us during one of the Lapita excavations. As a conclusion, I'd like to say this. As an individual trains to become an archaeologist, he or she is taught how to plan an excavation, execute the plan, and analyze the findings. Equally important to these archaeological discoveries is the dissemination of these findings back to the people from these places where the discoveries are made. In this way, not only are you assisting in the education of the people you come into contact with in the communities you work in, but also, once they begin to understand the nature of your work, you are doing and the importance of it in their life, the people will appreciate your work and will look forward to your return. You establish this link between yourself and the communities, and when nurtured, you will always be supported by these people whenever you go back to their respective communities. Due to the extensive awareness program carried out by the Vanuatu Cultural Centre over the past years, an ever-increasing number of people in Vanuatu are becoming more aware of the importance of archaeology. The reaction we get from many people when we talk about Lapita are one of shock, surprise, and excitement, and are always keen to know more. Sometimes they think we know all the answers, archaeologists, about the past. But we always tell them that there's always limitations in what you can interpret from the findings you have under the surface. For example, we are regularly approached by people asking if we can dig up a grave to prove the person buried there is one of their ancestors. They want us to do this so that they can lay claims to the land. And of course, we kindly tell them, such things are not really possible. The Vanuatu Cultural Centre Archaeological Awareness Program has come a long way, and it has proven that a country like Vanuatu in the Pacific, with limited funds, but with a lot of effort from our one small step at a time approach, can achieve a lot in the long run. It is far from over. For us at the Vanuatu Cultural Centre, it is only the beginning to make the whole of Vanuatu understand and appreciate the rich and valuable past, and to share it with the rest of the world. Custom, culture, and tradition are very important to the people of Vanuatu and to the Pacific as a whole. It defines who we are, where we stand in the world today. The rules, regulations, guidelines, and oral traditions that defines one culture from another are based on age-old knowledge passed down from generation to generation, ever-evolving, and though much has been lost, that which remains are highly guarded and continue to pass from generation to generation. Archaeology is therefore a very important aspect to the people of Vanuatu, in that it provides this tangible link, something you can hold, that connects the people with their past, and it can work in collaboration with oral tradition to assist in giving a better picture of how our ancestors lived in the past. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your time. I just want to flash up this picture as a result of our work in archaeology. We've last year had, very fortunately, our illustrator, his cousin, who's a carver, carved this carver bowl with Lapita motifs on it. And that is probably one of the first really good feedbacks from the community. And I believe in the near future, we will have more and more positive feedbacks from the community and more good, interesting things from the community. Thank you very much.